about what lies ahead. Now, of course, me being the third speaker to come on and deal with matters essentially related to Ezekiel 38, you will appreciate there will be a bit of overlap here. And so where I think there is too much overlap, I'll just sort of race through my PowerPoints. But as you see there on the screen, I think that that slide actually is a good summary of the situation in Israel and the world today. It's a window with so many bricks being thrown at it. And that really is Israel, because wherever you look around the world, Israel is not liked. Very few places is Israel liked amongst the nations. But let us just go back a bit in time before we come to what's happening in the future. Now, Carl has mentioned about the Iranian deal, and I think that when John Kerry came back waving that bit of paper, as it were, to the American public, it said it all. Peace in our time. And Obama said it would resolve by diplomatic means one of the greatest threats to world security. What I think is sad, brothers and sisters, about all this is that these world statesmen, John Kerry, Obama, whoever you might like to talk about, they're genuine men. They've got a desire for peace. I don't think they're out to sort of kid us. They really want peace, and they feel as though they're getting somewhere. But unfortunately, they won't get it, because we know what the scriptures say about the future. And so when Kerry comes back by saying, we've got peace, and Obama says this is the greatest deal, you know, for all time almost, they're sadly going to come to the realisation that this is not the case. Now, let me just take you back a few years, 7 years in fact, to Obama's comments in 2008, where he made it very clear that if Iran would not come to the table and agree not only to suspend her nuclear ambitions, but also to scale down dramatically her hatred of Israel and the threat to annihilate Israel, then he said, if you refuse, we will ratchet up the pressure. Now, that was said in 2008. So what has happened in the 7 years? They've got a deal now with Iran, but Iran is still vehemently anti-Semitic and has made it very clear that she intends to carry on with her desire to annihilate Israel. But again, Obama has said, look, it's my name on this, take it. It's my name, I've given my word, and you can rest assured that what we have promised, we will deliver. Look, from 20 years from now, I'm still going to be around, God willing. If Iran has a nuclear weapon, it's my name on this. So he's staking his name, his authority, his status on the world scene on this famous deal. Greg Sheridan, the foreign editor of The Australian, said, you need faith to trust Iran because there's no evidence for doing so. And I think his comments are very true. Now, one of the reasons, brothers and sisters, in fact, the major reason why this deal will not succeed is because of words of scripture. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? So it doesn't matter what deal is agreed to today, what document is signed, what piece of paper is waved in front of a society. The fact is, we're dealing with human nature, and human nature, unfortunately, has that bent towards evil. And as far as the American leader saying they have peace in their time, it reminds us of those words in Thessalonians, for when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Of course, the reaction from Prime Minister Netanyahu of Israel was something that we would expect. What was accomplished last night in Geneva is not a historic agreement, it's a historic mistake. Brothers and sisters and young people and friends, the Prime Minister of Israel is a very astute gentleman, and I don't think we can overestimate his ability to read the political scene very clearly. I think he can see where things are heading. He's been able to read Iran far better than the American statesman, and he can see that eventually Iran is going to break that deal. Now, we know they're going to break the deal, not necessarily in a nuclear capacity, but they're going to break the deal because they will be allied with Gog, when Gog invades the Middle East, as we have seen this afternoon. What about Iran's long-term ambitions? This was said in the midst of these discussions. Militia chief Mohammad Reza Naqdi said that erasing Israel off the map is non-negotiable, according to an Israeli radio report. And he also threatened Saudi Arabia, saying that the offensive that the Saudis are conducting in Yemen, as Brother Carl has pointed out this afternoon, the Saudis will have a fate like the fate of Saddam Hussein. And we all know what happened to poor Saddam. So where is this leading to? Ezekiel 38 makes it clear that at the time of the end, Persia will be with all those allied powers associated with Gog in the great invasion of the Middle East. But what I think has come out of this, brothers and sisters, is this, that the Middle East powers, that is the Sunni powers and Israel, have perceived that the United States and to a larger extent the Western powers have lost their guts, you might say. They've lost their desire to actively go in boots and all and defend the situation of their friends. And so I've headed this under the weaker West. Now we all know that the challenge to Gog in Ezekiel 38 is written like this. The merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof, shall say unto thee, that is Gog, art thou come to take a spoil? Hast thou gathered thy company to take a prey, to carry away silver and gold, to take away cattle and goods, to take a great spoil? So the indication from those words in Ezekiel 38 is that whatever response the West has to the invasion by Gog, it is not a strong response. If it were to be a strong response, I don't think we would be reading the language we have that there in Ezekiel 38 verse 13. It wouldn't be just like a question, have you come to take a spoil? It would be more of a belligerent response. Now don't get me wrong, I don't doubt that there will be a belligerent response of a sort. But the response that comes from the West is couched in such terms that they're almost caught off guard. They are surprised by this lightning invasion. And they almost try and stop the invasion by diplomatic means. And this has been the pattern of the Western's response to Russian aggression over the past few years. Everything has to be done diplomatically. And it's a well-known fact that the United States particularly and the European Union especially will not go to war with Russia over Ukraine. Mark my words, brothers and sisters, Ukraine will be a dead duck as far as Western response in supporting her. The West do not want a war with Russia. And I think Ezekiel 38 verse 13 indicates the response to the invasion from the King of the North. Now the Arab powers, particularly Israel and the other Gulf powers, can see this quite clearly too. Under a heading, US missing in action in Arab wars, we have these words from the Wall Street Journal a few months ago. The US has served reliably as guarantor of Gulf security for much of the past 25 years. But as the US has moved closer to a nuclear deal with Iran, and as Tehran has expanded its influence in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon and Yemen, as Brother Carl has very capably pointed out today, the US traditional allies are increasingly concerned about a diminished US commitment. There is a growing desperation in the shadow of Washington's shrinking security role in the Middle East. So what has come about as a result of this Iranian resurgence on the world stage is that the Gulf powers, the Gulf Sunni state powers and Israel have seen the need to work closer together to resist and rebuff any moves for aggression from the Iranians. Now here's a map of the invasion of Israel, the new fledgling state, in 1948. All those Arab powers there, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, etc., all of them collectively, but not under a united command, but collectively they invaded Israel to try and snuff out the fledgling state. We now fast forward, brothers and sisters, for many, many years, to the year 2015, some 60 or 70 years later. And what do we find? We find that the Gulf Cooperation, which is made up of those powers there highlighted in orange, have this to say. Arab Gulf states increasingly align with Israel on Iranian nuclear threat. Like Israel, the Gulf Arab states are deeply sceptical about the current negotiations. Now, this was written, of course, before the deal was signed. They see them as a vehicle that will grant Iran both nuclear status and allow it to dominate the region. That's why more and more the Gulf states have drifted into strategic alignment with Israel on the issue. Now, it's not a full-fledged military alignment. There's nothing being put on paper, nothing has been signed. But behind the scenes, brothers and sisters, and behind closed doors, there's no doubt that there are discussions taking place between Israel and the Gulf states. They are all concerned about Iran's position. Brother Kyle put this slide up. I've got a different photograph than him, but the words are the same, so we won't dwell on it, except the bottom sentence. Saudi Arabia and Israel have found themselves increasingly united on a confluence of issues. Now, how does this fit in with Scripture? Well, as Brother Carl has pointed out, it fits in majestically. Here is a map of the Middle East and Sheba and Dedan. Now, as Brother Carl has pointed out, Sheba is down in the area of modern-day Yemen, whereas Dedan, well, there are some differences of opinion as to where Dedan is, but it doesn't really matter. The fact is that Sheba and Dedan are essentially ancient names for the modern Arabian Peninsula. And it is in that area that we find the closer and closer agreement with Israel coming forth. Now let's just go back to Ezekiel 38 again and think about those words about the resistance to the invasion by Gog. You remember a moment ago I showed you the quotation which said, "The merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof, shall say unto Gog, what are you doing here? Why have you invaded this country?" But what I deliberately omitted from that verse were the first few words. And those words are as follows. It is Sheba and Dedan and the merchants of Tarshish with all the young lions thereof. Now, as I've said before in another talk elsewhere, no word of Scripture is wasted. Why is it, brothers and sisters, that the resistance to Gog comes firstly, from Sheba and Dedan? Is it in fact the Scripture telling us that it is going to be the Gulf state powers that are going to be closer to Israel in the time of the end than the Western powers? To me, that seems to be the indication from Ezekiel 38:13. It's the Gulf powers whose interests are vitally at stake with Israel that are concerned about any invasion into the Middle East territory. And so they are the ones, first of all, that are named. They say to Gog, and then afterwards, the merchants of Tarshish join in by saying, "Have you come to take a spoil?" Now, I want us just to consider for a moment the countries around Israel and how they're shaping up. For example, Israel and Egypt are right now cooperating against militant Islamic terrorism in the Sinai Peninsula and Gaza. Now, of course, Israel and Egypt have had a peace agreement since 1979, so we would expect them to have some common ground in fighting an enemy. But, you know, even though they've had a peace agreement for many years, many decades, the fact is that Egypt and Israel are not the best of friends. But nevertheless, they have agreed to cooperate in fighting the militant Islamic terrorism that is developing in the territory of Sinai and Gaza. To the north, we find that Turkey has recently confirmed a pact with the Saudis to help against Assad's power in Syria and to help the anti-Assad rebels. We find that there is an article recently, or a conference that was held, in which the subject was Turkey and Israel shifting alliances in the Eastern Mediterranean. You know, you only have to think of just a year or so ago when Turkey and Israel were at real loggerheads. And at one stage, they were going to just virtually sever relationships altogether. But you see, as Brother Carl has pointed out, the shifting sands of the Middle East, in particular with regard to ISIS and the influence of Iran, has caused these Middle East powers to think about their future and to think about where they are heading, depending on who is their aggressor. And Turkey has come to realise that it is in their interests also to get closer to Israel. So have a look at this map here. To the north we have Turkey, that is closer to Israel. We have Egypt closer to Israel. We have Saudi Arabia that is now aligning herself more with Israel. We have Jordan, who many, many years ago also signed a peace agreement with Israel. So you've got those major powers that are now either openly or secretly coming to terms with aligning themselves with Israel. And I think, brothers and sisters, that is one of the major effects that has come out of the rise of Iran as a power on the world scene. Because Iran has, in effect, been able to fool the Western powers, and whereas Israel and the Gulf states have not been fooled by Iran, you have the exciting situation whereby the Gulf states and other surrounding nations are becoming closer and closer to Israel. And that is exactly what we expect to see from Ezekiel 38. It's most interesting, Brother Carl has already mentioned today how that Egypt will remain as an independent state right until the end. And also in Daniel chapter 11, we read very clearly that when the king of the north comes down, it is Turkey that is to be attacked, is to be invaded. Turkey will receive the full brunt of the invasion by the king of the north. So isn't it significant that you have Turkey invaded by the king of the north, we have Egypt also taken by the king of the north, and we find that Israel is also in the sights of the king of the north. So these powers today are becoming closer and closer aligned. And I think it shows us quite clearly, brothers and sisters, that the situation of Ezekiel 38 and Daniel 11 is remarkably coming to fruition before our eyes. Now here's a picture of the taken from the Life magazine in the upshot of the remarkable Six-Day War in 1967. Now, when Israel won that Six-Day War, effectively there was worldwide euphoria about Israel's remarkable success. And you know, Israel was looked up to by the world's nations as being a great little nation that was able to defend itself and defeat the combined armies of all the Arab powers. There was not a lot of anti-Semitism, or there was not a lot of anti-Israel around the world in 1967. So much so that when the United Nations Security Council got together and came out with Resolution 242, they made it very clear as part of that resolution on the 22nd of November 1967 that Israel has the right to live in peace within secure and recognised boundaries free from threats or acts of force. Now that was 1967, nearly 50 years ago. What do we find today? Our title is Israel, What Lies Ahead? You know, today Israel is not in that position. Israel is under fire. The cartoon depicts, you know, hundreds and hundreds of bombs and rockets being fired towards Israel. And the poor Israeli on the tank is being reprimanded. How dare you defend yourself? You know, as if Israel is in the wrong. And the world's press continually presents Israel as being in the wrong when she attempts to defend herself against the rockets that are continually fired by Hamas and Hezbollah to the north. That is Israel today. What about this statement, brothers and sisters, issued by the chief rabbi of the United Hebrew Congregation of the Commonwealth? Jews today are hated for their nation state. Israel, now 67 years old, still finds itself the only country among the 193 in the UN whose right to exist is routinely challenged and in many quarters denied. There are 102 nations in the world where Christians predominate, and there are 56 Islamic states, but a single Jewish state is deemed one too many. What a statement from that chief rabbi. A single Jewish state is just one too many. And as far as Israel giving up land so that the Palestinians can form their state, these words from Netanyahu, I think, are very telling. I remember the international community's applause that the government of Israel received when it decided to unilaterally withdraw from Gaza. We got applause and then rocket fire. We left Gaza and Iran entered through their stooges, Hamas. Exactly like what happened in Lebanon. So under those circumstances, do you really blame the Israeli Prime Minister saying just before the recent elections, if I get elected, he says, there will be no Palestinian state on my watch? And I think, you know, it's fair for him to say that. Admittedly, that is not all that he said. What he said was, there will be no Palestinian state under the current circumstances if I'm re-elected. But the papers, of course, wanted to sort of, as usual, paint the Israelis in a bad light. And so he came out, as far as the papers were concerned, by saying there will be no Palestinian state. But brothers and sisters, what do the scriptures say? It's very interesting that in Ezekiel 38:8, when Gog invades, it says, after many days thou shalt be visited, Gog. In the latter years thou shalt come against the mountains of Israel, which have been always waste, but it is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them. So the record tells us very clearly that at the time of the end, when Gog invades, Israel will be dwelling safely, confidently. How is that going to happen? Brother Carl has already mentioned about the Hamas and the Hezbollah terrorist movements, whose charter is to completely obliterate the Israeli state. How then will peace be achieved? Do you know what? I don't know. And I don't think any of us know. But something's going to happen to enable Israel to live in relative peace and safety. And I think that to a degree, it will be those agreements or arrangements, secret or otherwise, between Turkey, Egypt, Saudi Arabia and the Gulf states that somehow will enable Israel to develop a society that, despite the aggression that may come from Hezbollah and Hamas, she'll still be able to say we live safely and confidently. And for that reason, I believe that the record is telling us in Ezekiel 38 that when Gog comes down to invade, the mountains of Israel, which is the territory of the West Bank that the Palestinians want for their state, will still be in Israeli hands. Whether that remains to be seen, I don't know. But, you know, the scriptures indicate that that territory will be under Israeli control, and that is the reason why Gog wants to take it. Now we're going to turn to the matter of anti-Semitism. You know, anti-Semitism as a phrase was only first used by a German journalist in 1879, and it was used to describe people who hated Jews. He argued that everything that was wrong in Europe was wrong because of the Jews. Well, we know where that led to, the terrible Holocaust of World War II under the Nazi regime, when 6 million were killed. Now, you know, it was a result of the Holocaust in World War II that the world's sympathy was directed towards the Jews, which enabled the United Nations on the 29th of November 1947 to vote for the partition of Palestine into an Arab and Israeli state. The Jews accepted it, and 6 months later they got their state. The Arabs rejected it, and here we are today, and they still haven't got their state. But that was the feeling of the world towards Israel and the Jews because of what happened to them after World War II. But you know, brothers and sisters, a lot of water has gone under the bridge since then. And here we are now in the year 2015. And over the last few years, we've had anti-Semitism rising its ugly head, predominantly in Europe, but certainly not only in Europe. And there was an article recently of Anti-Semitism Roundup, Timeline of Growing Pressure on Jews and Israel. Newsweek had a title, Exodus, Why Europe's Jews Are Fleeing Once Again. Prime Minister Netanyahu came under fire, fury as Israeli PM tells Jews to flee Europe. Now the next slide, it's got a few words on it, but I think it's very important for us to read this because it shows us what is happening in Europe, brothers and sisters, towards Israel. And what I'm trying to paint for you at this time is, in the time of the end, effectively, Israel will be alone. The scriptures reveal that no one will like Israel. She will be hated all around the world. And that is why the nations come down to invade Israel. They want to grab Jerusalem. They want to grab the holy sites. Effectively, they want to wipe Israel off the map. And that's the position of Israel. Now, what's happening in Europe is systematic, is that the right word? Symptomatic, that's right, yes, of what is happening in many places. The article was written by a gentleman called Giulio Miotti. If there's any Italians here this afternoon, they can help me with my expressions later on. But anyway, we'll stick with that at the moment. Giulio Miotti, otherwise known as the chief spaghetti maker in Rome. Now, there is something shameful in the speed with which Europe now turns against Israel. Israel's points of view and reasoning are disappearing from Europe's newspapers. Europe's diplomatic echelons, political officials, intellectuals, writers, journalists, heads of churches and labour unions are all asking Israel to commit suicide. Now, why are they asking Israel to commit suicide? This is how they are getting around it. They say to Israel, why don't you become a Jewish ghetto in an Arab state, or an Arab sea, I should say, relying, now note this, relying on the guarantees of secularism, democracy, and respect for minorities that is clearly offered by the PLO, the Iranian mullahs, and the Syrian generals. You know, these are wonderful men. Just accept the fact that you will be left in peace as just a little enclave in an Arab sea. In Europe today, there is a kind of anxiety focused on how to get rid of Israel. Now, Mr. Miotti, an Italian journalist, has just published a book about the Vatican in Israel entitled Jacques, The Vatican Against Israel. So I've had to translate two things today. I might have to speak Italian, now I'm speaking French, Jacques. And if any of you know anything about history, it's all about the famous case of Alfred Dreyfus, the captain in the French army that was unjustly accused of selling spies to the German state. And a few years later, an author by the name of Emil Zola wrote a book entitled Jacques, in which he exposed for all the world to see the injustices that were handed out to this French Jew, Alfred Dreyfus. So this writer is now accusing the Vatican also of getting up to all sorts of tricks. But what really impressed me, brothers and sisters, was that quotation from Numbers 23:9, where Balaam expressed what will be the case in the time of the end. For from the top of the rocks I see him, and from the hills I behold him. Lo, the people shall dwell alone, and shall not be reckoned among the nations. And what we are seeing today, I believe, is that situation developing. Israel dwelling alone. For world peace, the placard says, Israel must be destroyed. In the United Nations, from time to time, they have condemnations against nations. Now look at the list of those nations there. We won't read them all, but as you will see from quite a few of them, they are all, certainly aren't they, peace-loving nations. Why, we've got Libya, North Korea, Russia, we've got Syria, we've got Iran, we've got, Iraq, say. Now, look at all the condemnations that have been issued by the UN against those nations. Some of them zero. North Korea has had one. Poor Israel has had 20 condemnations issued against her by the United Nations. Israel shall dwell alone, said the prophecy in the book of Numbers. Did I have that screen? Sorry, I didn't know whether you had that screen up there when I read that out. So there it is. There are 20 condemnations against Israel in the year 2014 by the UN and all those other nations that are well known for their terrorism and their withdrawing rights from their citizens. They've had very few condemnations listed against them, but Israel has 20. Now there's the traditional picture of the nations that invade Israel. And of course they are the ones in red. The ones in blue are those that stand up against the invasion. What I think is significant, brothers and sisters, is I showed you that map a moment ago of the nations that are now cooperating with Israel. Here we have a map of the nations that are going to be against Israel. It's interesting that the Bible makes no statement whatsoever in Ezekiel 38 of any of the nations immediately around Israel as being against her. So Egypt is not mentioned as being against Israel, nor is Jordan, nor is Saudi Arabia, nor are the Gulf states. So clearly, I think we are seeing developing on the world stage the situation as we have it presented in Ezekiel 38. The time is coming when Gog shall be addressed. Thus saith the Lord Yahweh, in that day when my people of Israel dwell safely, shalt thou not know it, Gog? You'll come down like a storm to cover the land. And God will gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat. And when it all seems as though it is lost, Yahweh will roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem. The heavens and the earth will shake, but the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. It'll be a time, brothers and sisters, of Jacob's trouble. And as a result of the invasion by Gog, and when Israel is almost destroyed, and when their Messiah is revealed to them, the one third will be brought through the fire. Yahweh will refine them as silver is refined and test them as gold is tested. They will call on my name and I will answer them. I will say, this is my people. And each one will say, Yahweh is my God. And they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son. And in that day, persecution and hatred of the Jews, as we see it today, will end. This is a remarkable quotation from Isaiah 51. Thus saith thy Lord the Lord, and thy God that pleadeth the cause of his people. Behold, I have taken out of thine hand the cup of trembling, even the dregs of the cup of my fury. Thou shalt no more drink it again, but I will put it into the hand of them that afflict thee, which have said to thy soul, as we have it depicted there on the pictures, bow down, that we may go over. And thou hast laid thy body as the ground and as the street to them that went over. What a picture of the Holocaust, and many times repeated. Now, just in conclusion, three slides, Gary. Recently, my family went to Israel, and amongst other things, we went to the Negev, the desert area, to a place called Sadeh Boker, and that's a kibbutz area, and it was the place where David Ben-Gurion, after he retired as Prime Minister, built his home. And we went into his bedroom, and there's a picture of his bedroom with his slippers there on the mat, looking remarkably like the ones I've got. And you see on the side of his bed, there are a pile of books. Now, you can't read what those books are, but let me zero in on those books. Look at the one way down the bottom that he was reading, The Indestructible Jews. And I thought that was so fascinating, to go into that bedroom, to look at the pile of books beside his bed that he was reading, and there was the book, The Indestructible Jews. Fascinating to see that. And David Ben-Gurion, in my view, brothers and sisters, was raised up by God as the man for the day to bring the state, or the Jews, to statehood. And just one more comment from a very famous Jew who unfortunately perished in the Holocaust, Anne Frank. Who has inflicted this upon us? Who has made us Jews different from all other people? Who has allowed us to suffer so terribly up till now? It is God that has made us as we are, but it will be God, too, who will raise us up again. If we bear all this suffering, and if there are still Jews left when it is over, then Jews, instead of being doomed, will be held up as an example. In those days it shall come to pass that 10 men shall take hold of all languages of the nations, even shall take hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew, saying, we will go with you, for we have heard that God is with you. Anne Frank perished in the Holocaust. But you know, like scripture, her words still speak, and that quotation is yet to be fulfilled. Israel shall blossom and bud and fill the face of the world with fruit.